Hello and welcome to the program DPR, the Nigerian Petroleum Industry Regulator. Today our focus is on the nation's frontier basins. For many people these words may sound strange, but for those in the oil and gas industry, they are common words used for where exploration activities for oil and gas have not been carried out, or an area with short-term exploration for oil and gas activities but assumed to have significant volume of hydrocarbon. Nigeria has 7 of these basins. Now, the target by the federal government is now to increase Nigeria's crude oil reserve to 40 billion barrels and a daily production to between 3.5 and 4 million barrels. Petroleum analysts believe that with concerted efforts at these inland basins, this goal will be achieved. Now you may ask, what is the Department of Petroleum Resources doing to explore these inland basins? Well, you have to wait for the answers after our usual DPR tidbits. I'm Sulaiman. The chairman, Major Marketers Association of Nigeria, MOMAN, Mr. Adetunji Oyebanji, has described the role of the Department of Petroleum Resources, DPR, as a challenging one of balancing its role as a strict regulator of the nation's oil and gas sector, on one hand, with selling a positive image of the department to the world, on the other hand. Mr. Oyebanji said this while presenting a paper as a lead discussant on downstream issues during the recently concluded Strategic Public Affairs Workshop for staff of the Public Affairs Unit of the department in Lagos. Mr. Oyebanji noted that the downstream has evolved over the past few decades in terms of technology processes and standards. As such, DPR, as an industry catalyst with peculiar challenges, needs to reposition itself to be able to tackle emerging challenges. Mr. Oyebanji also emphasized that industry players must work at reducing sharp practices to the barest minimum. Assistant Director and Head Public Affairs Unit, DPR, Mr. Paul Osu, disclosed that the department will follow up on the knowledge gained at the workshop with necessary action to ensure that its outlined 2020 strategies are realized.
Everything that we put together here in terms of knowledge base, we're going to follow it up with action to make sure that our strategies as outlined in our document for 2020 is realizable.
Global trends in oil and gas investments in 2020 have shown that operators will continue to push for faster returns with shorter cycle investments as the industry moves away from giant developments. Global data energy analysis shows that even for integrated developments with midstream components, projects now go from final investment decisions, that's the FIDs, to first oil and gas within 3 to 4 years. Aside phased approaches, shorter development timelines are enabled by continuous push towards standardization, both with production, drilling, and well design. Furthermore, according to Global Data Energy, the offshore environment continues to inch towards subsea tiebacks and floating production storage and offloading FPSO units are the dominant development concept. Now, demand for natural gas is expected to accelerate in 2020 as it will increasingly replace coal and gas for power generation, as well as being employed increasingly as a main petrochemical feedstock. Turkey has received an invitation from Somalia to explore its waters for oil. According to reports on national television, Turkey had signed a maritime delimitation agreement with Libya's Government of National Accord last year. An exclusive economic zone can be established from Turkey's southern coast to Libya's northeast shores, and the Turkey-Libya relationship could also attract international oil companies. Seismic studies have shown that there could be oil and gas resources in offshore Somalia. Not long ago, the upper house of Somalian parliament had approved a new petroleum law, which it expects to attract investments from big oil companies. Since the Somalian famine of 2011, Turkey has been a major source of aid for the country. Turkey has helped it build roads as well as trained its soldiers. President Tayyip Erdogan has confirmed the Somalia offer. Nigeria has 7 frontier basins. They are Niger Delta, Dahomey, Anambra, Benue Trough, Chad, Bida, and Ilomidan, better known as Sokoto-Rima Basin. Of these basins, the most explored and exploited, as well as well-known, is the Niger Delta and its offshore. The other basins, known as inland basins or frontier basins, have had little or no efforts made to explore them. Petroleum analysts believe that the federal government's push to increase Nigeria's crude oil reserve to 40 billion barrels can only be achieved by exploring and exploiting crude oil in some of these frontier basins. But how has the Department of Petroleum Resources aided this all-out quest to explore some of the unexplored frontier basins?
Crude oil exploration in Nigeria began in 1908, mainly in the Niger Delta Basin by a German company. They, however, left because of the First World War. The company was substituted by a Royal Dutch company, Shell Darkey, whose efforts were truncated by the Second World War. They later came back after the war, this time around as Shell BP. Their exploration efforts was then limited to the Niger Delta and the coastal and shallow water areas. These efforts yielded fruit in 1956 at Oloibiri in today's Bayelsa State. About 7 years later, Chevron discovered the Okan field and the first commercial offshore field in 1963. That explains why among the sedimentary basins in Nigeria, aggressive exploration has been concentrated in the Niger Delta, as the region is said to be very prolific. Since then, this basin and its continental shelf have been highly prolific in the production of crude oil and natural gas. Today, almost all the production of crude oil and natural gas in Nigeria is concentrated at the Niger Delta Basin and its territorial waters, and yet there are other 6 inland basins to explore. Geologists believe that many major depositions have resulted in the formation of about 6 other sedimentary basins in Nigeria where active petroleum exploration activities can be carried out, although a few of them have seen some activities in crude oil exploration. The basins are Anambra Basin, Benue Trough, and Bida Basin. Others include Bronu or Chad Basin, Sokoto-Rima or Ilomidan Basin, and the Dahomey Basin. The Anambra and Dahomey basins are producing crude oil now. Geophysicists and geologists have shown that the Niger Delta Basin has maintained a thick sedimentary apron and salient petroleum geological features favorable for petroleum production, expulsion, and trapping from the onshore through continental shelves and to the deep offshore terrains. They also believe that if intensive exploration is carried out in other basins, they will yield crude oil and natural gas in commercial quantity. Take, for instance, the Chad Basin, the lake that is right inside the arid region of the African continent and at the fringes of the Great Sahara Desert. The lake is shared by 4 countries: Nigeria, Cameroon, Niger, and the Chad Republic. The dryness of this area is exemplified by the dust blown by these vehicles and helicopters. Though this area obviously holds some secrets which it has released to other countries bordering it, it is yet to release this secret to Nigeria's side of the basin. That secret is crude oil in a commercial scale. It is on record that Chad and Niger republics on their own side of the lake have discovered crude oil and gas in commercial quantity. Yet, Nigeria, which has about 10% of the land, is yet to discover this precious mineral in spite of all the efforts. Ironically, this area belongs to one of the largest sedimentary basins in sub-Saharan Africa. The Chad Basin and the Benue Trough share the same stretch of depression known as the Central African Rift System. In geological circles, the Central African system is believed to have commercially viable hydrocarbon deposits stretching through its length and breadth. In fact, the sandstones in Borno, Yobe, Gombe, and Bauchi states of Nigeria on this long rift and marine depression are described as the hydrocarbon source rocks. On the other side of the basin, countries such as Sudan, Niger, Chad, Central African Republic, and Uganda have all discovered crude oil in commercial quantity. Yet, the efforts by Nigeria to explore for crude oil in this area dates back to the 1960s when the Nigeria National Oil Company, NNOC, was granted the right to explore crude oil and gas by the federal government. In 1989, the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation, which succeeded NNOC, created the Frontier Nigeria Exploration Services. The NNPC continued these exploratory activities in this basin until it was joined by some multinational oil companies such as Shell, Elf, now known as Total, and Chevron. However, this operation was called off in 2000 as a result of inability to find crude oil in commercial quantity. Meanwhile, NNPC, through its subsidiary, IDSL, was able to acquire about 32,642 square kilometers of 2D seismic data using explosives. It also drilled about 23 exploratory wells in the same area. Only two of the wells recorded non-commercial gas discoveries. The wells are Wadi 1 and Kinasa 1. The one big question that has continued to bother many geologists is that Chad, Central African Republic, Niger, Sudan, and Uganda, with the same geological formation as Nigeria's side of the Chad Basin, have been able to discover crude oil and gas in commercial quantity. Why is this eluding Nigeria? In 2002, the federal government directed that the data generated from the seismic study of the basin be analyzed further to find out the viability or otherwise of the basins. The following activities were carried out by the NNPC and its consultants: analysis of the existing seismic studies, the wells and geological data integrated studies. These were with the aim of evaluating and understanding the reasons behind the failure. As a result of the outcome of these studies, NNPC went back to the Chad Basin before the insurgents. They selected the Lake Chad Bada area, which is considered a moderate risk area for further exploration. This time around, NNPC used its own seismic company, Integrated Data Services Company Limited, IDSL, in conjunction with the Chinese National Oil Company, which helped the surrounding countries discover oil in the basin. The team deployed exceptional instruments to do the work. They used 3D seismic studies and vibrations rather than explosives. Given that the Benue Trough share the same geological formation with the Chad Basin, it was a good news recently as crude oil has been discovered in the basin. It is on record that the Department of Petroleum Resources worked aggressively with the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation in these renewed efforts to discover crude oil in the Komani River 2 well. On Anambra and Dahomey basins, crude oil has been discovered in commercial quantities and some private investors are investing there. The two other basins of Bida and Ilumiden or Sokoto basins, the Department of Petroleum Resources is very active in exploring for hydrocarbon in the Bida Basin. It is using what may be said to be unconventional exploration method known as radiometric survey. This takes into consideration the geological features that should be in place for hydrocarbon formation and accumulation. The methodology is an integration of sedimentological studies for field mapping, analysis of existing aeromagnetic data for basin thickness, geochemical studies for source rock, and radiometric measurement.
This is a special announcement from the Department of Petroleum Resources. Gas is safe. Gas cylinders are to be kept outside. If you're buying LPG cylinder, look for NIS number on the cylinder. Exchange of gas cylinders with retailers during purchase is best practice instead of refilling from another cylinder. Buy gas from certified LPG plant. Repairing faulty gas cylinders is unsafe. For more information, visit the nearest DPR office or our website www.dpr.gov.ng.
Many thanks for that well-researched background report. I hope you've learned a lot on the frontier basins of Nigeria. Well, I'll hand you over to my colleague, Antonia Amuzu, for a one-on-one interview on the Department of Petroleum Resources.
Thank you so much, Suleiman. This segment, I have Mr. Sani Hassan. He's the Deputy Director, Head, Basinal Assessment and Lease Administration at the DPR. Mr. Sani, you're welcome to our segment.
Thank you very much.
We want to start by asking you to briefly explain to us, when we talk of frontier basins, what do we really mean?
Let's start from the basis for the benefit of our viewers that actually are not technical. You know, we are talking of hydrocarbon here, oil and gas. Oil and gas are formed from organic matters. And when we talk of organic matters, we talk of plants and animals. You know, when they die, they get buried under the surface for millions of years. Under certain conditions of temperature and pressure, they form hydrocarbon. And this hydrocarbon, oil and gas, can retain where they are, or they can move to another place. And what will make them stay is what we call a trap. If there's a trap around where they are formed, the source rock, they stay there. If they are not formed, they have to move to look for a trap where they can stay. So there, the oil and gas is being formed. And we human beings, with our training and technology, we explore and produce these hydrocarbons.
Okay, well, I understand that in Nigeria, most of these basins are always inland. When you talk about inland, what do we now mean?
To give you the example of those frontier basins, one is a Chad Basin, we have Bida Basin, we have Sokoto Basin, we have Anambra Basin and Dahomey Basin. If you relate it to the location of the Niger Delta, which is the matured basin now, most of them are inland. They are on land and they are also in the hinterland of the country. So the term inland is referred to them.
So on the scale of 1 to 10, how do you rank the level of hydrocarbon exploration in the inland basins?
Well, to be honest, the inland, the frontier basin, is very low. When you look at 1 to 10, I give like 2 or 3 for the inland basin.
So if it's that low, is there any prospect for us still exploring for hydrocarbons in those places?
Yeah, there are. You know, just like a businessman, as I told you, you know, we're still with the matured basin. Everybody is there because it's producing, it's giving us what we want. So we don't even worry much to take the risk to look for these hydrocarbons in other places. But now that our matured basin is not enough for what we want, we have to go out and look for more. One, because federal government wants to increase the reserve base from the 35, 36 billion we have to 40 billion. And we feel like we need to look at other basins that can give us that additional reserve that we are looking for.
So in what way is DPR encouraging exploration in this basin?
Usually what we're supposed to do is to encourage investors, you know, to go there and acquire the data and maybe sell for businessmen, those who want to buy. Because there are companies specially designed to acquire data and sell. But because those basins are a little risky, so most businessmen don't want to go. So it's DPR that actually doing some in collaboration with FES, the Frontier Exploration Services of the NNPC.
So when you say you are trying to encourage them, what way do you encourage them, if you can be more specific?
For the businessmen?
Yes.
Well, one of our job here Actually, it's not, if you remember, it's to do licensing round. So what you do in licensing round, you give out blocks that have good data. Blocks that don't have good data, no investor will come and buy. Or at worst, they will price very cheap, and you have no option but to actually sell to them. So what DPR is doing is we de-risk the blocks. So we do as much as possible to gather data that we can attract investors to come and bid for those blocks.
So would you say that DPR is conducting any exploration activity in any of these basins right now?
Yeah, for now we are doing with a company called Tatnet. We're acquiring data. We have already acquired data and built that basin. And then together with FES, Frontier Exploration Service, or NNPC, we are working in Benue and Chad Basin together with them. But DPR alone is working in the Bida Basin.
What made you go after Bida alone?
Yeah, because of previous work done in Biza by universities. They have taken a lot of samples and they have convinced us that that basin is good enough to hold hydrocarbon. Yes.
Well, so is there any prospect? And how soon do we hope to see it?
Yeah, for now, we can't say because we employ a company called Tatnet, I told you, that they came with a special technology called radiometry to acquire the data. So this is done with a special aircraft. It's not done on ground. It's an aircraft that fly over the basin and collect the data. And what they do is that they do what they call hydrocarbon imaging. So it's a little technical.
So what would you say is the level of acceptance of this project by both the host government and then communities where these explorations are taking place?
Oh, it's fantastic because we started, you know, when we went to the Niger, we first visited the governor. We have been hosted by the deputy governor. He was so happy. So many people were there. All the commissioners came in. We had a discussion. From there, we went to Bida, visited the MR of Bida. He received us fantastic with all his some chiefs around. And he made a promise that he would tell all the chiefs.
Oh, wow. That's good to hear. So there was no hostility from the community?
Nothing. They are so happy, clapping, and giving us all the support.
Like, how long does this explore, this activity take when you go in?
Yeah, that is the advantage of the radiomet. It's like 2 weeks. Maximum that it took to acquire this data. So that's the advantage of it there.
So you said you use unconventional technique. Can you shed more light on how this data now is acquired using this unconventional
technique? Yeah, usually there are two ways of the data acquisition. We have what we call conventional and non-conventional. The conventional is what everybody is used to. That's what we call the seismic data acquisition. The issue with seismic data is that it's expensive, very expensive, and it takes time. But it's the most accurate of all the data, because it's the most developed among all the data acquisition system. But with this one, in 2 weeks, you have done that, which the seismic cannot do. For seismic, you have to cover all the basins with the data. But with this conventional, it focuses on the area where there's a possibility of having a hydrocarbon. So once you have that, you can now bring your seismic to cover that particular area, and then with the two, exact yourself, and it's cheaper.
Is there a possibility of the country attaining this 40 billion oil reserves that the federal government is aiming for?
We are hopeful to do that. By the time we explore very well some of these frontier basins, do some of this deep offshore, as I said, we here are hopeful that we'll hit or even more than the 40 billion the federal government is targeting.
Yeah, but this has been on for quite some time. Why have we not been able to attain this expectation?
The issue of exploration has been at the low all over the world. Most companies don't want to invest money in exploration. That's the reason, because they feel they better stick with what I'm producing. So why do I need to even go and look for money? And to be honest, the story we get is that banks don't want to give loan on exploration. So you have to use their own money to explore. So it's difficult, but we have prospects that if exploration starts in this country, we'll hit the 40 billion or even more. So the only thing is that we need to go and campaign, to the oil companies to go ahead and do more exploration so that they will do a lot of discovery.
Okay. Is it possible to have incentives to encourage them to go do more exploration?
Yeah, federal government has given good incentives so far for most of them. They have incentives, they enjoy the incentives. And so it's that the mindset and then getting that investment into the exploration. That's the issue, not the incentive that federal government gives here.
Oh, that's very educative and very enlightening. So I want to thank you so much, Mr. Sani Hassan, the Deputy Director and Head, Basinal Assessment and Lease Administration at the DPR. Thank you so much for
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anthony. Well, we're seizing this opportunity to ask investors to invest in these inland basins. There are great opportunities there. Yes, there are. Now, you have heard of the discoveries at Benue Trough and Anambra Basins, Bida, Dahomey and Ilumiden or Sokoto Basins equally offer the same opportunities. Now, here I draw the curtain for the day, but do not forget to join me for a more interesting topic same time next week. It's goodbye.